Women's rights begin in the womb. Equality begins in the womb. Peace begins in the womb. Fatherhood begins in the womb. None of this is true. To understand this, we have to take a close look at the biological beginning of a human being. When you ask a pro-life advocate the question, when does a human being's life begin? They'll almost assuredly say, at conception or at fertilization. And they're right if they understand that to mean that the very beginning of the process of when the reproductive cells come together. Now, according to the Carnegie stages of embryonic human development, the newly created human being begins to exist when a spermatozoan makes contact with an oocyte or its investments and ends with the intermingling of maternal and paternal chromosomes at metaphase of the first mitotic division of the zygote. In simple terms, a new human life is created at the beginning of the process of fertilization. And I say process because fertilization isn't a single moment. It's a beginning, a middle, and an end. And where exactly does that meeting happen? A honeymoon vacation is a good place to start. Except I'm talking about the biological reality of a human being coming into existence. The process of fertilization doesn't happen in the womb. The womb is where the embryonic child will implant, but he came into existence before that in the fallopian tube. In normal sexual reproduction, sperm travels through the uterus and into the fallopian tube where it'll seek out an oocyte. This is where the process of fertilization happens. It's also the place where an identical twin comes into existence, or monozygotic twinning to be precise. It's also what makes hormonal contraception so deadly to the developing human embryonic child. If the new person has been created while his mother is using hormonal contraception, well, there's a chance that the epithelial cells that line her uterus will resist implantation. And that new child, created in the image and likeness of God, well, he soon dies. And not by any natural means either, but by a chemical cocktail engineered to snuff out a unique human being's life at its most vulnerable phase in the event her contraception failed to prevent ovulation and fertilization. So, if you think human existence begins in the womb, it's not exactly supported by the facts of human reproduction. Why then do pro-life advocates use this term? Maybe they just consider this entire area as the womb. Perhaps it comes from the prophet Jeremiah, the popular passage that reinforces the pro-life position. Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Or Psalm 139, for it was you who formed my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. But these authors aren't giving us a lesson in human embryology. They're telling us that God's love is so great that he loves us even before we came into existence. We exist because of his love. It certainly makes for cute marketing for things like stickers and signs. Pro-life from womb to tomb sounds a lot more poetic than from tube to tomb. Fatherhood begins in the oviduct. Still, we can't ignore one important detail, and that is, not everyone is created sexually in the fallopian tube either. Sadly, some people are created in the cold petri dishes of in vitro centers and embryonic stem cell labs. Don't they possess the same human dignity as those people who came into existence inside their mothers? So what can we say begins in the womb? Most of the preborn child's development will happen there. After all, he'll be living there for 9 months. His heart will begin beating in the womb. The formation of the tiniest details of his human anatomy, like fingernails, eyes, hairs, little toes. They'll all begin in the womb. And if he enters a Planned Parenthood, then his death will begin there too. And even that isn't a guarantee, given the exposure of Planned Parenthood's willingness to manipulate abortion procedures in order to deliver intact human heads and beating hearts. So why? Why does any of this matter? Who cares if we say in the womb? Well, because as we learned over the past few decades, what we say has a significant impact on the laws we pass. You see, the words we choose to use today, they creep into the legal language put forth in modern legislation. And in turn, these words become the legal loopholes that policymakers are so fond of exploiting. Take pregnancy, for example. We understand pregnancy to mean a mother has within her another human being. To the abortion propagandist, pregnancy doesn't begin until the child implants in his mother's womb. Therefore, they can confidently say, and they wouldn't be correct, they would say that birth control and emergency contraception, they don't end a pregnancy because, well, she was never pregnant in the first place. And this is the problem with phrases like begins in the womb. This language ignores the child that is still making his way to the womb. It ignores the child creating in vitro. It ignores the embryonic child who is condemned to die in stem cell labs. Referring to every aspect of human rights as beginning in the womb, well, it's a misrepresentation of our position as pro-life advocates. Science is already on our side. We don't need to betray the facts just so that we could sell a cute t-shirt.